Hello to all of you. I'm Julia, and I'm the Secretary General of NEMO, the Network of European Museum Organizations. I'm very happy to welcome you to this first webinar in cooperation with our associate member NEMECH and the University of Florence. Today we'll hear from them a bit about new media for cultural heritage, and I'm super happy because we had a lot of interest from a lot of people for the seminar. The seminar was completely booked after a short period, so that means that there's a big demand. So I think this is something that we are going to continue. The basic idea behind offering these webinars to museum professionals all over Europe is to empower them and to support them in their professional development. And what we want to do is to apply a European scope to it, and that's what we do at NEMO. So I think what we firmly believe in is European values, and we want museums to cooperate across borders to learn from each other. So within this year, we'll be organizing two other seminars, webinars, one on emotions in museums and exhibitions, and one on museums and intercultural spaces. That's something that relates to the migrant situation in Europe. But now I think I'll leave the floor to my dear colleagues, Alberto del Bimbo, Andrea Ferracani, and Daniele Pezzatini, to enlighten us about new media and techniques for cultural heritage that they have developed. Thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy the webinar.
Good afternoon. Do you hear me? Alberto del Bimbo is speaking from University of Florence. And welcome to everybody. And we will give a 15-minute presentation of new digital tools and techniques for cultural heritage and museums. And it will be followed by two other 15-minute presentations by Daniele Pezzatini and Andrea Ferracani. The goal of this presentation is to have a short introduction with some examples on a few technologies that are available today and can be exploited in museums to improve the quality of presentations and offered to visitors. So let's start with these introductory issues and talk of a few technology trends. I will follow these trends with two examples we are currently doing in Florence, and that hopefully will give you some idea of what can be achieved today. So first of all, a few statements. The blue sentence has been taken from the literature, and it's a broad definition of what museums should do: expanding our knowledge, stimulate our senses, expose to new experiences, and engage the participation of visitors, sharing history and natural world. But we believe that information and communication technologies has given a very important opportunity today. The opportunity to turn visitors from being passive observers to being instead engaged participants. So that means that the visitor can give a contribution within the museum and can receive personalized information from the museum and cultural heritage sites more in general. So one very important point of this age is that ICT technology today can be human-centric instead of object-centric as has been in the past. So in other words, provide the support for the visitor directly, not only just to complement information about the objects exposed. And another very important point is that we can really today start giving user-centered, personalized dialogue between the museum and the visitors. In other words, addressing each individual visitor with his or her individual interests and behavior habits. So let's see why and how the information and communication technology today can do this new trend. Well, here I reported recent statistic on mobile and social. In other words, how much mobile devices have been expanded today and how much the social platform are followed today. So we have currently about 7.5 billion people in the world, and about 2 billion of them use mobile systems and social platform on the mobile system. So that's a very important. So about 1/3 of the world population is using mobile and social platform on mobiles. So sharing all the data that they can capture with their mobile system. But if this is the picture of the today situation, we are going towards a very different context that is the sensor-based context. There is a Gartner estimation given in the late 2015 that estimates that in the 2020 we will have about 21 billion sensors connected to the internet, so providing data. And this data can be everything is connected to object. So we can estimate object states like temperature or conditions, or also proximity of people to objects and so on. So this is the true revolution we have in front, using sensors. And eventually, very sophisticated sensors like cameras or voice recorders. Another very important trend is the miniaturization of technology. Here in this slide, I reported an announcement that was made in the early 2016 by Heptagon Company in Singapore, that announced that in 2 square millimeter area, they were able to put cameras, sensor electronics with some important features. So a lot of things just in a very small 350 microns thin sensor. So that means that we will be able to wear these sensors like buttons of a jacket. Another important point is the capability of making user profiling. Already today, we know that we are profiled. We are profiled using business platforms, about our interests, or let's say macro interests. And you know, people selling objects greatly rely on this platform to suggest new objects to buy or share. But we believe that when we talk about cultural sites and museums in particular, this kind of macro interests are little useful. In particular, when a person is making a visit in a museum, for example, of course, is attracted by, you know, objects that reflect their macro interest, but much more are attracted by artworks and objects based on temporary interests. So the interests at that specific moment of the visit or at that specific emotional condition during the visit. So we believe that analysis, as is obtained by social data and big data that we live in the internet, is little useful to provide personalized experience. And given the trend of using sensors in the very next future, we believe that interest can be discovered, the temporary interest during a visit can be discovered and answered thanks to sensors more than thanks to social networks and social data. We talked about the capability today already to have sophisticated sensors, sensors with intelligence. Well, machine learning and artificial intelligence has made enormous progresses in the very last few years, let's say in the last 4 years, and particularly the deep neural network technology has made fantastic progresses in recognition of visual data and recognition of audio data. These kind of networks are artificial networks that in some way try to reproduce connectivity that is in the human brain in a completely different way, of course. And they have been applied in a lot of fields, and today, especially in the field of computer vision, there is huge progress in this area that makes that gives the machines the capability to see and understand the content of images they see. This capability in computer vision can be exploited usefully in museum or cultural sites. So what I will give you in the next few slides are two examples of the current possibilities of this technology in museum sites in Florence, in experiments we have done. And I want to suggest that these kind of systems are really capable to understand contextual behaviors and situational conditions of visitors in museums. That means they are capable to provide the visitor the right information they need given the situational interest and at the right time and the right place. So let's see the first of these two examples I have prepared for you. This example is the NEMOzain project that was funded by the regional government of Tuscany and is now under test in a museum in Florence, the Bargello Museum. This museum is a museum of Renaissance artworks, particularly there are important statues by Donatello, Michelangelo, and other 16th century sculptures. There is a huge room, the so-called Donatello room, where there are about 10 important masterpieces of the 16th century. And well, the visitors usually go there and well, they are astonished by the place, but it's hard for them to understand what an artwork means to, you know, get a complete picture of why that artwork was done and so on. So what we believed was why don't give more information to the visitor, but only for those artworks that are really interesting for the visitors. So we had to measure the interest of the visitor, of each individual visitor, to the artworks exposed and analyze what artworks were most interesting for them. So we put four cameras in the hall, and these four cameras have the duty to observe the visitors and their behavior. So where they stop, where they look at. And in the end, the system tried to understand which one of these artworks were really interesting for the visitor. At the end of the room, there is a table, an interactive table, where if the visitor came close to the table, the system tried to recognize the visitor among the very many visitors the system has observed and understand his or her interests and provide more in-depth information only of the artworks of maximum interest for that visitor. So let's see a short video that show what happens. I just play the video. And this is the Bargello Museum. Formerly was a prison, but now is a fantastic place. I suppose that some of you already has visited that. And this is this huge room where we installed cameras. You see a camera on your right side. You have four cameras here depicted in this slide that cover almost all the area of the hall. Around each artwork, there is an area of interest, so that these ellipses that you see depicted in the images, so that when a person enters the room, the system detects the person. You see the squares, the rectangles around the persons, and assign the person to the artworks where he is close at. So you can see the different colors of the rectangles that are the same of the artworks of the ellipses to which the person is associated. This is done by the system in real time. That means 15 frames per second. So the system has to detect the person and associate the person to the artworks. Of course, we want to provide individual answers to the persons. So we have to distinguish each person from another. To this end, we provide special descriptors that give individual representation of the visitor. When the visitor gets close to the table, you see here in this slide, then the system takes 10 seconds and presents what the system has understood about the interests of the visitor. And you see different green colors. That means the more the green, the more interest is the artworks. And you can interact and look in depth more information about stories of the artworks and so on. This system is currently under test. But we have a detection rate about 70%, which is relatively high, and an accuracy of profiling that very high, close to 90%. That means we almost are able to understand all the artworks that really were interesting for the visitor. So another project we are doing that is showing to you the capability of computer vision to understand what is in front of the camera is this intelligent audio guide project. In other words, we want to provide a guide to the visitor that is able to detect what object the visitor, what artwork the visitor is looking at, and providing information about that object. So differently from the current audio guide, The system has not to type any number or that the in that gives that says the guide which artwork is in front of, but the guide understands what artwork is in front of the visitor just from the camera. So we have a system that you see on your left side of the slide, which is a tablet, simple tablet system, so very light to wear. And we implemented in this system this deep network architecture. And the system is wearied by the person, so that when the person enter in the room, the system camera looks at the artworks and distinguishes whether it is an artwork, what the camera sees, or a person. And you see in the background some persons coming, for example. And as you get closer to the artwork, the system is able to detect which artwork is that. So recognize the artworks among the artworks exposed in the museum. This is done automatically in real time. What you see now is just the prototype system wearied by one of our students that simulates a visit in the museum. So he come close to the artwork and the system recognize which artwork is that with no mistake. So it's not a miracle, but is simply a system that has been trained to recognize these artworks and distinguish these artworks from people, independently of the viewpoint, the illumination conditions that are very many different from site to site, and also independently of the fact that the artwork is partially occluded or not, and also despite of the difference between artworks. So this system is able to have almost no false detections and recognition. And we plan to build a working system from this prototype very soon. So these are just the two examples I promised, and they were just to show you that some intelligent sensors are really on the hand today and are already possible to be implemented in interesting solutions for giving visitors individual information, so the information that they really want to have. Thank you very much. I will pass the position of speaker to the next speaker, that is Daniele Pezzatini. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, so Professor Del Bimbo give you a very broad and like state-of-the-art view of what we can do with technology now, and he gave a really like state-of-the-art insight of the research. Andrea and I will try to do now is to give you some example of application and technology that you can adopt, which is already available in the market, so something you can already buy and use. So some of the opportunities that these technologies offer, the one that we will discuss today, are to understand the context and the location of a visitor inside a museum or like generally in an indoor space, and provide information accordingly. Other technology we will discuss today allow user to interact physically with digital content. We'll see what that could mean. And also can allow to explore in an immersive way virtual environments that can be recreated from real environment or from environment that are not available anymore. So we will start with the example, and then we will give you the explanation behind the example on how the application was developed. The first one we will show, which is about the use of context and location inside the museum, was developed in the museum and house of Rubens in the Netherlands. So the museum developed an application, and they provide visitors with a tablet. And as the visitor walks through the museum, to the indoor and outdoor space, the tablet can detect where the user is, exactly which room and what artwork are next to him, and can provide him with information. Like now you see that the application detected that this visitor was in the courtyard. He showed information about the courtyard. And then as the visitor proceeds in his visit, there are like more in-depth information about the artwork the user is currently watching. So here, for example, there are these seek and find game where the visitor has to find relatives of Ruben inside his artworks. So the way this application is done is using this iBeacon technology. Some of you maybe have already heard of this technology. It was introduced in 2013 by Apple. And this small colored thing you see on the right side of the slide are like 5 centimeters big transmitter. And they use this Bluetooth low energy technology, it's called, to communicate wireless to smartphone and tablet that are nearby. So basically what they do, they are just notifying continuously their presence. And so a tablet who is passing nearby one of these transmitters can understand which transmitter is in the proximity, and therefore understand the location of the visitor. So this small transmitter, you can buy from several manufacturers. I brought you here some reference, but you can really find many now because it's they are like product really diffuse in the market. So what can we do with this sensor? As we discussed from the example, using these beacons, we can understand the location of the user inside our museum, and therefore informing with a contextualized information, which is triggering on the app the information about the artwork or the object or the room in which the user currently is. And this can be done similarly with other technology. You might have seen QR code or near field communication application. But in these cases, the user is always required to actively do something, either to scan a QR code or to put the phone next to a sensor. In this case, iBeacon works without the user triggering any input. They are low energy consumption. That means that they have a battery inside that lasts around 2 years. So once you position them in the environment, they can stay there for a long time. And they are low cost devices because each of them now costs around 20 euros. There are also some that cost like 5 euros, and maybe they have a lower battery life, but the price of these devices is decreasingly month by month. So in order for a museum to adopt this technology, which are the requirements? So from the museum side, it's required to install these iBeacons in the environment. This means that museums should buy enough of this beacon to be placed in the room. Okay, the range of this transmitter is around up to 50 meters. But the more beacons we have, the more precision we can have in detecting where the user is. We can reach a precision of a few centimeters, for instance. Another thing that a museum should provide is an app for a mobile. So basically, there should be a software house or a developer who should, with the museum, develop an application for the various platforms like Apple, Android, and it also, and the museum also has to promote this app to the visitors so that they know that when they enter the museum, they, if they want, they can install an app and lead this interactive experience. On the other side, the museum can either provide visitors with tablet, as we saw in the example, the tablet was given to the visitor by the museum, but one of the trend now is called bring your own device, where the visitor is supposed to already have a smartphone, and this is most of the case a true scenario. But the requirements we need on the smartphone of the visitor is that he has a smartphone with this Bluetooth low energy support, and the support is now active in almost every smartphone sold after 2013. So in the next few years, we could consider every new smartphone as Bluetooth low energy enabled. The Bluetooth sensor must be switched on, and the visitor, of course, must install and launch the app that the museum provided. So he just have to open it and leave it in the background. And so whenever he approach an active spot, the app will give him a notification that he's around a place with information, but he has to install it. So as I said before, the way this technology works is that this small beacon that you see here, the yellow and the blue, they transmit continuously an identifier number. And the phone, the smartphone and the tablet that are in the range of this transmitter, they can understand the distance, or approximately can understand the distance from which these sensors are transmitting. So as you can see in the small image, the phone is currently sensing the blue and the yellow beacon. And so he's able to understand that the phone is approximately closer to the blue one and 3 meters from the yellow one. So as I said before, the range, the maximum range is around 70 meters, but they can also work in a less powerful transmission, so they can only be identified within few centimeters or within few meters or even more. One of the main problems of this technology is that when trying to estimate these distances, the signal can be noisy, because this Bluetooth wireless signal can be absorbed by liquids such as the human body. So if there is a person between the phone and the beacon, the signal is absorbed. And also environmental elements like walls and columns, they can reduce the strength of the signal. So that could cause problem when trying to localize. So one of the best thing we can do with this application is to understand when the user is next to a point of interest. It's a bit harder to understand exactly and with high accuracy where the user is, because that might vary based on the noise. The next technology we will introduce is what we call physical interaction. So I will explain you some of this technology, and then Andrea will continue on this trend. With physical interaction, we mean that the user can interact physically with digital content. And like the most famous example of this metaphor is the multi-touch surface. So here, the example I've selected is in the Smithsonian National Museum during an exhibition about the city of Cusco in Peru. And so what they did, they developed this multi-user interactive application that is presented on this big screen, which is 82 inches wide. So more than one user can interact at the same time, and they can explore the city of Cusco even from the Smithsonian Museum. They can navigate through 3D models, or also street views, and activate interviews and study some architectural elements that are reconstructed in 3D, by touching them, so interacting directly with the physical content. Another example I selected for you is the Auckland War Memorial Museum, where the multi-touch experience that we are mainly used to see in many museums is enhanced with the use of interactive objects. So basically this colored object you see on the surface can be manipulated by the people. In this case, it's a game for kids to learn how to find, let's say, treasure, but mainly it's like to explore and to find historical items in the territory. So in this case, the multi-touch experience is also enriched with a physical object. So physical object can be used directly on interactive surface to collect digital elements. And this, of course, is really entertaining, especially when we are doing an application for kids that can actually interact with physical objects. So the interactive tabletop technology is something that is pretty common to see in a museum. The first prototypes of this technology were already introduced in the 80s, mainly in research centers. And then now we are all used to use multi-touch technology since the smartphone diffusion. So basically the way they work, these are like screens as a normal displays, but they have means to understand where the using is touching and to track the movement of the user finger on the surface. And by this, it can provide the user with some gesture, such as in panning a big surface or zooming, so to enlarge picture and going in depth and have a more broad vision of multimedia content. The opportunities that this technology offers is that interacting directly with digital content is much more natural than interacting with keyboard and mouse as we are used to do with our laptop, because we can directly touch the content we want to activate. Also, the idea of the table is something that already belongs to the human society. So the table is an object that is common, is an object that call for collaboration, because it's a place where more people can gather. And so this creates new opportunity also to create new digital application and to experiment also the interaction between people and to provide them with information. So since the multi-touch table is a physical object, when a museum wants to adopt one of these tables, there are also some physical thing that we should take care of. One of these is called affordance. So is the property of an object that defines its possible use. So in the case of a table, the way we set up the table define also the way people will use it. So if you see on the left, if the table is placed next to a wall, then the active user will just go on the long side and all the other visitors will stay on the sides. But if you put the table in the middle of the room, then visitors will approach from every side. And so this enhances interactivity. Another option is to put the table, in this case, it's called surface or interactive wall, in a vertical position so that only user facing it can interact. Just to mention the few problems that this technology introduce. One is the cost, because these display, the bigger they are, the more they cost. Let's say for a medium to large size display, we are around 5,000 euros. And also this in technology is mainly used standing, so the people would suffer from physical fatigue after a long session. So usually they are not meant for long content, long text or long videos to be watched. So I think, yeah, I finished my part, so I thank you and I will be available for questions, and now Andrea will take.
Okay, hi all, I'm Andrea Ferracani, researcher at MICC, and Daniele has already introduced the subject. So I will talk about two widespread technologies used for building smart and engaging applications also in cultural heritage. And these technologies are the Microsoft Kinect, which is a device able to capture the movement of users, and the Oculus Rift, which is a immersive display. And first of all, we talk about the Microsoft Kinect, but I'm going to show you a video of an application realized with the Kinect. And this is an application developed in 2013 for the Night of Museums in the Hungarian National Gallery. And the installation was created by the Google Art Gigapixel project, which is a project by Google aimed to provide big, very, very big images of artworks. Imagine that these images are about 1 gigabyte. And okay, I show you this application, which uses the Microsoft Kinect. So as you can see, there's a user that can zoom, and then zoom on the interface, and it moves in the space, stepping forward, backward, and also aside. So stepping forward, you can zoom on the image, and stepping forward, you can zoom out of the image, and stepping aside, you can change the artwork. So the application is a demonstration that applications can use physical position of users and physical interaction of users. And okay, you can also point with your hand and decide which part of the artwork you want to see. Okay, so I have given you an idea what you can do with the Microsoft Kinect. But what it is, the Microsoft Kinect? It is a device capable of detecting the movement of the users, and also to track all the joints, the skeleton joints of the users. So you can control an interface without using additional controllers like gamepads or Wiimote if you are used to gaming consoles. And the device has been created in 2009 by Microsoft and has been integrated in the Xbox console for gaming. But from 2012, Microsoft has also distributed a development toolkit, so you can use the Kinect to build your own applications. Okay. There are two versions of the Kinect, and which are version 1 and version 2, which have different capabilities. And so different resolution. Obviously, the latest release has a better resolution. And which are the data that the Kinect can capture? Essentially, the first image that you see in this slide shows what the Kinect sees using the RGB camera. So essentially, it gives a representation of the world like the one you could have taken a picture with your phone camera. The second one, it's a view from the depth camera. So the Kinect generates a depth map of the world, where each point of this grayscale map represents the distance from the sensor. So if turn into the previous slide, if you watch the bottom right image, the version 2 of the Kinect, you can see that the Kinect has a RGB camera from which he has taken the first image, and a 3D depth sensor, so he can have this representation in grayscale of the distance of all the objects with respect to the sensor. How it works with this technology? The Kinect has an infrared emitter and also an infrared camera. So it casts point lights on the object that are in front of the device, and it's able to understand from the deformations of these point lights on the objects the distance of that point with respect to the sensor. So I to give you an idea of what the Kinect sees of the world, this is the sensors, and okay, this is, oh sorry, this is the position of the sensors. Okay, and as you can see, the Kinect radiates all the room with point lights. From the deformation of this point, he understands how far is each of these objects. So it's a cool technology. And okay, he can also understand joints informations. So on the right lower side of the slide, you can see the Vitruvian Man, which is the famous drawing from Leonardo, drawn in 1490. And the Kinect can track up to 25 body joints. So you can understand of each user where he is moving his right hand, his left hand, his left foot, and so on for 25 joints. And it can also track up to 6 skeletons. So 6 person can move in front of the Kinect, and the Kinect can understand the position of all the joints of each of these 6 persons to control the applications. This is a table which represents all the capabilities of the two versions of the Kinect with the differences, and I list them all. You can detect persons up to 6 persons, so you can understand that there are 6 persons. You can track skeletons, all the joints, the position of all the joints of the users up to 6 in version 2 and up to 2 in version 1. And it can track 20 joints in version 1 and 25 joints in version 2. You can understand if you close or open your hands in front of the device. And in version 2, it is also able to understand the body tilt. For example, you can use the tilt to build gaming applications or fun applications. In version 2, it is also capable to identify gestures. So if you make some gesture with the hand, swipe, and so on. Face recognition is enabled in the two versions. And version 2, it can also understand emotions. So if you are laughing or you are angry, and so on. And speech recognition is also supported, so the development kit can also understand what you are saying. So you can build interfaces which can react to speech from to what you are saying. Okay, which are the opportunities of using the Microsoft Kinect for building applications? It is very useful when you need to detect people presence. So let's imagine that you want to start a video, start an applications, or switch on a light when someone in the museum enter a room or pass by. Okay, and it's suitable for natural interaction applications. So for applications that do not require the users handle or control the interfaces with additional device like console or special controllers. So only using their hands and their movement. And also is very suitable for interactive installations which provide gaming capabilities or use physicality, where you can move and act as in the real world. Which are the limits of this kind of applications? The Kinect has a limited detection range, so it can see people only in a certain range, which is from 0.5 meters to 4.5 meters in depth. So it is not suited for a very large hole. You have to dedicate a special room for this kind of applications. And I have already said that it supports up to 6 persons. So for example, you cannot build a football game because you need 12 persons. A strong limit is the fatigue due to prolonged use. So you have to stand up, you have to interact with your gestures, so you can stay a long time interacting with this kind of applications. It does not work well in bright rooms because, as I said before, it works understanding and calculating the distance of objects using infrared light. So if you have a room with large windows where the sunlight filters, it cannot work well. And it is also sensitive to noise and occlusion. So you have to provide a dedicated room because if a user is interacting with the interface, but someone passes by or occludes the users, the application can not react consequently. How difficult it is to use the Microsoft Kinect? It's very easy if you have an application. So you have only to plug in a device on your laptop or your personal computer. You have to install a software, but it is very easy to use. The application have to be developed by a developer. Okay, now I'll talk about the Oculus Rift, the other device, which allows to build immersive environments. And here an example from the European channel, where you can see a user with a display on the head that play with the Oculus. And as you can see, it can move inside a reconstruction of a museum. You have the stroboscopic view, okay? And now, okay, as you can see, you can enter the room and you can have a real experience inside the environment. Okay, the Oculus Rift is only a display that can simulate immersion of the user in an environment. It was created by Palmer Luckey, and that is a self-taught engineer and a passionate of electronics. And it was founded on Kickstarter in 2012. Which are the opportunities of this kind of technology? You can experience in first-person virtual places. And these places can be in the real life inaccessible due to several reasons. So, for example, imagine that you want to experience the Mosul Museum in Iraq, which has been destroyed last year by ISIS. You can do this only with this kind of technologies. These technologies gives also the capability to interact with the objects you can see. And this is not always allowed in a museum. So for example, imagine you can touch the object or because they are in glass cases and so on. But in a virtual world, you can touch the object and have insights or ask insights about the object itself. And you can also make pre-visits to arrive prepared to an experience. So imagine you go to the Louvre and there are a lot of artworks. You don't know anything about the artworks. So if you have pre-trained your ability to recognize or you have information about the artworks, your experience can be more engaging. One of the limits of this technology is the so-called virtual reality sickness. And it is a feeling of dazed and nausea than a user can feel when using the Rift, due to the fact that what your eyes see is not in synchro with what the body feels. And this issue has been mitigated in the versions, in the more recent versions of the Oculus Rift through the use of the tracking of the head. So you have a camera, you can put it somewhere in the room, and they try to understand your movement, the movement of your body. And another issue with the Oculus is that it has a not so good resolution, but it has been improved in the commercial version, which is the last one. And so, as you can see, there are three versions of the Oculus: development kit 1, development kit 2, and the last one. This is the commercial version, where they have also introduced a controller through which the system understands the position of your hand, and you can also grab object, move in the space, and so on. Also, the Oculus is very easy to install. So you have to plug in the Oculus via USB and a software. But to build the application, you need a software developer. Okay, I show you a demo of the Oculus, and this demo is about the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And as you can see, you can do cool things. Okay, I'll show you. This is a famous painting by Salvador Dali. You can enter, you can move in the hall of the museum, but at a certain point in this application, you can also enter the painting that was painted by Dali in 1931. And you can have information about all the objects and all the meaning of the painting. And the objects in the painting, so the meaning of the melted clocks, the hands on the mirror, and so on. And at a certain point, you have also a button where you can disintegrate the painting. And this seems very strange, and someone could think that you are violating the artwork. But as you can see, there's a fish that pass by and the ants that go away and so on. But if you know the story of this artwork, it is really a demonstration very close to the reality, because after the Second World War, Salvador Dalí also painted another painting which name is The Disintegration of the Persistence of the Memory, where he disintegrated all the painting because I was a passionate of nuclear physics and was very impressed by the explosion of the atomic bomb in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And okay, I close with a little note about another technology, which is the leap motion, which is very similar to the technology I showed you with the Kinect, but it is dedicated to tracking joints of the hands. So not only you have the joints of the body, but also all the joints of the hands. And this is an experiment, the last video, and then I close, which use all these technologies together. So you have the Oculus Rift, an immersive reality in a museum. You have also tracking by Kinect sensor, and a leap motion to track the joints of the hands is mounted on the top of the Oculus, so of the display you have on the head. And this is an experiment that we have done at our center to understand which is the best way to move naturally in an environment, and in particular in a museum environment. So you can you can use your hand to give a direction, pointing your finger in the right direction, and you can stop opening your hand. Then you can you can move your hand like a lever to control your movement in the space. and you can point objects to understand and to have insights. You can also walk, so you can simulate walking by swinging your arms and moving inside the museums, or you can also, using a widespread metaphor, which is walking in place, to move in the environment. So the aim of this demonstration and of this experiment is to understand how it is better to give the possibility to move to a user in an immersive environment. Okay, I have finished. Thank you. It's time for a question.
I saw a few questions regarding my talk, and I want to answer to some of them at least. Let me find them. And first of all, there is a question, a comment, I would say, by Rimer Knopp, that I want to answer. The comment is, I suppose, regarding the prototype system we have installed in the Bargello Museum that observes the visitors trying to understand their interests. So the question is, a nightmare of the surveillance state, is the museum really interested in me? Question mark. So, well, it looks like a nightmare, but indeed it's not, for a lot of reasons. Well, first of all, the system is very privacy respectful because does not store any information about any image of the face of the people or of the people as the whole. It only translates the image of the people in a long string of numbers that is used internally to the system to make calculations and evaluations. So the picture of the person is not stored and is not recoverable in any way. So it's very privacy respectful in this sense. And the direction of the museum was very careful on this topic. And but the question is the museum really interested in me is, I believe, very interesting. Because first of all, it's not only the viewpoint of the museum that is interesting here. Of course, the museum can get information about what the visitors are interested in the majority, for example. But the problem is not the museum viewpoint, is that is the visitor's viewpoint. So thanks to this technology, the system can understand what are the individual interests of the visitors and provide to the visitor the information they are really interested in. So probably a more appropriate question is the visitor really interested in having this information, in-depth information about the artworks he visited? That is probably the right viewpoint. At least this was the goal of the application. And a preliminary answer we have is that not all the visitors that are in the museum are interested in receiving this information. Particularly, we measured in a period, 6 month period, an average rate of 35% of people that went to the table to receive the more in-depth information about their artworks. they are interesting artworks. So how to make people more interested in receiving more information? That's a question that we don't know how to answer. That's a question to put the museum eventually. So there was also a question by Ariane Fradkur. Apologize for the wrong pronunciation. And that is, are the arts was geolocalized in advance, or are they recognized visually by the device? I suppose this question is regards the application of the mobile wearable audio visual guide. Artworks are not geolocalized. So artworks are recognized by the vision system on the wearable device. That's the really technological hard part of the research. So Marty Locht asked, why not use iBeacon technology? I think that Daniele answered very in depth about the limitation of the iBeacon technology. That is, when the environment are crowded, is crowded, well, they doesn't work, they don't work. If there are occlusions, they don't work. You have to have a device on you that is Bluetooth enabled. Otherwise, you don't receive information. While these applications are simply let the user very free to move in the room without making anything with the device, just switching it on. And you receive, in this case, in our case, information in audio directly by the system. So then there is another question that is worth to be answered. Isn't the original placement of the artworks interfering of how much popularity they receive from visitors? Well, this is a good question. Of course, the answer is yes. Yes, in the general. In this case, she also asked, have you tried to switch their places? Unfortunately, these are statues, marble statues, so very, very heavy and cannot be moved easily. Not for a test, at least. But of course, the results from the system provides useful information to the museum curators to understand whether an artwork is in the right position or not. If they want is more visited, they have hints to move the artworks elsewhere. Of course, this in easier places than the Magello Hall, it is very easy to move artworks from one place to the other. So this is also useful information that can be obtained from these technologies. Okay, I believe these are the questions I would like to answer. There is another one?
Yeah.
Which one?
Okay, there's the Romana.
How
many people can detect?
I suppose Anna Huthan asked how many people can the system detect in one time? And then can we know about cost of the system? Well, the system has no, I suppose you refer to the observation system with fixed cameras. Well, the system has no limitation about the number of detections. Of course, there can be missed detections. Very far objects or persons usually are not detected. But the miss rate is anyway low. I provided us some figures in the slides. Slides will be available to the people attending the webinar, by the way. So the answer is there is no limitation on that. Also for the wearable system, there is no limitation. People there is in the view of the camera is detected, if any. So about the cost, well, as I told you in my presentation, this system is just a research prototype. It is installed for test. So it's not on the market. And frankly, we don't believe we'll be on the market. These systems have to be personalized to the context of application.
Okay. So I also have also some question about the topic I covered. Starting from the eye beacons, I saw several comments that were pointing out that the technology can be extremely unreliable when, especially when there are many objects close together. That's true. In a context like the one we saw in the example, which was a concept of an application, if in a room I have many, many paintings, many, many objects of interest, and so the distribution is dense, and I have many points I want to understand when the user is next to, that could be problematic, because this eye beacon transmitter can be configured to like have a range of like a couple of meters, but also it can be reduced to a few centimeters. But of course, the more we reduce this power of transmission, the closest the user has to go in order to actually trigger the information. So the problem is always to find a good balance between the density of the spots we want to turn into interactive spots, and the amount of beacon we want to put. So basically, it has to be a compromise on how many artwork and how dense they are. And so also I saw another comment from Marianne about interactive tables. So basically the one I talked about are interactive tables that can be purchased and they can work directly. So the metaphor of the table is the one that has been used. Basically these devices are big screen, like the one you can use for the television, but they are augmented with touch and multi-touch capabilities. So you can either use it at a table or as a wall. And you were asking about tables on the ground. So you can make a pavement interactive. There are many installations of interactive pavement where there is a projection that is reacting to the people passing on the surface. That can be done. Basically, we can turn every surface into an interactive surface. But in this case, we have to use cameras. So we have to use either something like the Microsoft Kinect, as we saw, but also other kind of cameras that can track people movement and change the projection and the environment accordingly. So we talked about the table because these are the ones that basically can just be purchased and used as they are. So, and of course, it's really interesting your point that they are not the best or the only metaphor of an object where people gather around. So I use the metaphor on the other way around. So it is a table. The table is also a place where people gather around. That doesn't mean that other metaphor cannot be used to gather people next to an interactive system. So I think I covered the comment on my side, so I can pass okay. The word to Andrea.
I want to answer to Vic Jansen, I hope to pronounce correctly. And his question is, why would a visitor come to a museum to use the immersive natural interface MICC project? So the interface I showed with a combination of Kinect, Oculus Lift and Leap. There's no reason why a user should come to the museum to see to use this virtual installation, except for the fact that it's always better to see objects in real life, but in some cases it is not possible. So for example, for a destroyed reconstructor, inaccessible, or even a temporary closed sites, you, the museum, can offer anyway an experience of the artwork or the environment and so on. You could also use the augmented reality, so using mobile apps with some vision capabilities to augment the reality. But anyway, with in this way, you have to be in that place. You have to see things with your camera. So in some cases, this is not possible. And a system of this kind can also be useful to have pre-visits, as I said during the presentation. So when you want to go first of enjoying the real life, you can have a preview of what you will see, and you can arrive prepared to the experience. Thank you.
Question by Maya Minoska, that is, maybe all these technologies could be used more as a mean for increasing accessibility for disabled visitors and enhancing their experience. Yes, I believe this is a very important point. One important application of this technology is to improve the visitor's experience. And particularly, this improvement has value for disabled people. So, for example, you can imagine the importance of the so-called intelligent audio guide for a disabled person that, you know, is not capable of using his or her hands properly. And so the system can help their experience, to improve their experience in a museum and make the museum accessible to everybody. Yeah, that there is, the answer is yes.
Hi all, and I'm happy to be here and to talk about the new technologies inside museums and innovative technologies. But I think it's important point is to know the interest of the users. And so my colleagues explain well everything. Now I can close the webinar, and I hope you can also see the video recorded in the NEMO website, and there are also the possibility to give a statistics of the webinar. So see you next time. And I hope it's okay for you. It's and see you next time, next webinar.
Feel free to send questions to us if any. Thank you very much.